I want to thank Steve Caplin. I know we all want to thank Steve Caplin for being here and agreeing to share his secrets. I'm sure you all read his bio on the announcement page, but just to give you a little refresher, Steve is a professional photo illustrator specializing in photomontage. If you live in the UK, you've undoubtedly seen Steve's illustrations in your magazines and newspapers, both in the editorials and in the advertisement sections. But he's probably best known, at least to us, for his How to Cheat in Photoshop book series. It's one of my favorite Photoshop books. I can't recommend it strongly enough. His most recent book is Art and Design in Photoshop. He's also written and contributed to several others. Go to Amazon.com or wherever you like to buy your books and take a look for them. And I can strongly recommend purchasing the How to Cheat in Photoshop series. To see more about Steve and to see some samples of his work other interested links for him, you can go to stevecaplin.com. So, welcome, Steve.
Hi, Doug. How are you doing?
I've been
Have
better.
Have you got any questions yet?
I really wish this questions thing would give me some indications that it's working.
Well, should I be able to type questions from my end?
I don't think you can see it.
I can see a questions pane, but I can't click on it.
There you go. Well, I see. That's news to me. I wasn't aware that you could even see the screen. The forums are probably going nuts with, I can't see the question screen. Oh, boy, this is just so unprofessional. I'm going to try.
I wouldn't worry about it.
This is RetouchPRO Live, and that's the live part. Of course, so is this.
Maybe you should put your email client back on, and then people can always send you an email if they can't see the questions.
That's a really bad idea. Please do not email me, because I will get hundreds of emails.
Okay, no, fair enough. That's a really bad idea. Forget I said that.
Let's see here. So I am going to go ahead and switch over to your screen, and we can just begin this, and I'll apologize if the questions is not working, and I will continue working on it, but in the meantime, we can begin the presentation. So we should be slowly switching over to Steve's screen.
Okay, now, yes, show my screen. It says I'm on air. Are you seeing a Photoshop?
Yes, I am.
Window, yes.
Yes.
And we hope everyone else out there is also seeing a Photoshop window. So let's take it away. Okay, hello, everyone. Good evening in the UK, and good lunchtime in the States, and good morning, whoever is out there in New Zealand and had to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning to be here, which we really appreciate. So thank you so much for joining us.
You've got some avid fans, evidently.
Well, so it seems. Oh, either I have or you have. At least one of us does. Okay. Let me start off by introducing myself. I am a photomontage artist, as Doug said. And the kind of thing that I do is mainly editorial illustrations. I'm just going to show you one or two bits of recent work so you get some idea of the kind of thing that I'm up to. So this is a piece I did for the Guardian newspaper recently, and it was about Gordon Brown and Tony Blair making up. And it was a very, very straightforward montage, but the trick here was trying to make it look as realistic and as convincing as possible. It was a nice little job to do, very enjoyable. This was one for the Independent newspaper. Are these coming across okay, Doug?
Oh, it's coming wonderful so far.
Oh, good. This was for a story about what the world would be like if there were suddenly no people left in it. So it had to make sense as a cover, but then also when you zoom in on it, then you have to get all the detail in there, the broken windows of the
Oh, that's wonderful looking.
The plants coming up. Well, I tell you, the hardest part about this was doing the cutout of the London Eye, which is the most fiddly and irritating building I've ever had to
work. Look at that.
Quite appalling. This was earlier this week. This was for The Guardian again, and it was for a story about crop circles, and they wanted their logo, G2, the second section of the paper, made as if it was a crop circle. That was a tricky one to do. Had to make a special Photoshop brush to do the edges of the corn in here. See where it has to.
It looks very nice.
The edges. So it worked, and they were pleased with it, and that's what matters, really. This is for the cover of an Italian news magazine called Internazionale, and it was about Kim Jong-il and his nuclear weapons program. And believe it or not, the shot of him and all his cronies standing in this wheat field is a real untouched photograph, quite what he thought he was doing, being photographed in this surreal position. I can't understand. So I just put all the rockets taking off in the background and the sky and all that stuff there. We have a TV program in the UK called Top Gear, and it has these three rather loutish presenters. And this is
actually,
I
recognize one of them. I recognize, is it Gordon, what's his name in the middle?
The guy in the middle, yes. It's Jeremy Clarkson.
Jeremy Clarkson, yes, I've seen him.
Very opinionated. And this is for an edition of Radio Times, which comes out, I think, next week. And they wanted to know what the show would look like if it was presented by women. So this was a very enjoyable job turning these three presenters.
If I could interrupt you for
women.
A second, I wanted to tell everybody that you have solved the questions problem. You're all coming through loud and clear. It appears that, yes, Mac users are seeing it as well. So if anybody cannot see the questions pane, it's not my fault. You fiddle with the menus and like that because I've got 141 people saying, yes, I can see you. So,
excellent. We're live. Good.
Excellent. So I'm sorry to interrupt you there.
No, not at all. This is my Christmas story, actually. I was so taken with the idea of Obama becoming the president. Am I allowed to mention politics? Maybe he's not really politics.
I love that.
This was a fairly fiddly job to do, but I was kind of pleased with this one.
That's excellent.
This is a nice idea for a story.
Steve, if I could interrupt you here, the sound, your voice is distorting. I'm getting comments that nobody can understand. Maybe you could check your settings, and maybe that'll reset it.
Okay, am I too quiet? Too loud?
No, it's technical distortion. It has nothing to do with you and the microphone or whatever. I'm sure it's just the internet. But I wanted to just make sure that everybody could hear. And it'll come and go. And that's just, again, it's just life on the bleeding edge. It just proves that we're live here.
Okay, well, I'm talking now at a reasonable volume, and it looks to me as if I'm getting, quite a decent volume through the microphone.
It's getting better. There's still some static, but we can at least hear what you're talking about. I'm sorry for interrupting you. You can go ahead.
No, that's enough of that stuff. The only thing I will mention is my publishers insist on me talking about my books every now and again.
Oh, absolutely.
So here are my books. Absolutely, and there they are, and I put them away. We don't have to look at those again. Okay, so let's make a montage.
Wonderful.
And I'm going to start with this guy here. Our people from the UK will recognize him. He was our Prime Minister. I don't know if he'll still be our Prime Minister by the time we finish this webinar. We'll wait and see. Things are moving pretty fast here.
Yeah, I just saw he was in the news yesterday for something, some controversy or one or the other.
He's screwing up very badly these days. It's a great shame. Okay, so what we're going to do is take him, cut him out, put him on the new background, generally mess around with this guy.
That's what politicians are for.
And that's what they're for, exactly. So by far the best way of doing any kind of cutout is to use the pen tool. Now, the pen tool is a really tricky tool to get used to. It's possibly the hardest tool to learn in Photoshop, but you just have to get into it. So I'm going to start here at the top of his ear, and I'm going to draw around down the side of his ear, under his chin. And what I'm doing now is drawing a path with Bezier curves, as they're called. And these Bezier curves were invented by a man called Pierre Bezier in the 1930s. And he was an engineer who worked with the Renault car company. And he invented this way of drawing curves so that he could draw the shape of proposed cars more mathematically and more precisely. A little bit of detail in there. Okay, so I've started on one ear, and I've come around to the other ear, and now I'm thinking, okay, what happens now? There is no way I'm going to draw around every one of those hairs on his head. So what I'm going to do instead is cheat. I'm going to draw roughly around the outside of the hair, and then we'll cut that out, and then we'll see what we can do to make it look more like hair. So here I am, round at the end. That part is now complete, and we can hit Command-Enter or Control-Enter on the PC to turn that path into a selection. We can make that selection now into a new layer, and we can use Layer New and Layer via Copy. Now, I always prefer to use keyboard shortcuts because, you know, a lot of my work's for newspapers, and there isn't time to keep on reaching for the menus. I'm on a very tight deadline, so I'm going to be mainly using keyboard shortcuts from now on, but I'll talk about what they are, and I recommend you get used to using them. So Command-J or Control-J for this one, and it makes a new layer, and there we can see it in the Layers panel. Let's hide the background layer, and we can see, okay, we've got a nice smooth cutout along the bottom of his face and around his ears. That's all great. The hair, well, it's not very good. How can we make this look more like real hair? And the way that I like to do this is to use the smudge tool. And the smudge tool you'll find nested with the blur tool and the sharpen tool, and it's the bottom one of these three. And R is the shortcut for smudge. Why R? I have no idea. I guess S was taken by the stamp tool. Although R for rubber stamp would have made sense for the stamp tool, but there we go. So that's a smudge tool. And what we can do is click on the image and pull out strands of hair, and we can work our way around his head. Now, are you seeing those coming out? Or is this,
yes, you're actually rebuilding the hair rather than trying to show the original hair.
Exactly, rebuilding it strand by strand. And this can take a while, so a quicker way of doing it can be if we change brush from the standard small brush to maybe one of these spatter brushes. And they are a default in Photoshop. You'll find them there when you pick up the brush palette. And now when we go around, we can pull out whole chunks of hair at a time. There we go.
While you're doing that, Jared Wheaton would like to know why you use the pen tool instead of, say, a layer mask or something along those lines.
Okay, the reason I use a pen tool is kind of historical, because if I do a cutout with the pen tool, I can save the path that I've created inside the JPEG, and it saves it in a very compact format. If I did the cutout, say, with Quick Mask or with a layer mask, I would then have to save it either as a native Photoshop document or as a TIFF or as a PNG, and it would take up very much more space on disk. And the pen tool gives me a very clean path that I can always work with later.
Okay.
If that answers the question. Okay, so there we go. We go around, and there is Gordon now with rather more hair, convincing-looking hair. It's a little soft at the edges, but when we put it on any kind of background, that's going to look much more like real hair.
It's a good look for him.
It kind of suits him, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Now, I get a lot of images sent through to me by newspapers. I want to do a picture of, I don't know, maybe Barack Obama in bed with George Bush, for example. That one's unlikely. And they'll send me the mugshots of Obama, and they'll send me the mugshots of Bush, and they'll always be either looking straight at the camera or, in this case, gazing off at the distance. And in order to make people within a montage look like they belong in the same place, what you really have to do is to make their eyes look at each other to give the sense of interaction between them.
That's a good point.
So what I'm doing now, well, it's the key thing that makes people look like they're in the same space. So what I'm doing now is drawing pen paths around the inside of Gordon's eyes. Okay? Once again, I'll turn these into a selection. and let's make a new layer. And we can call this one eyeball. And I really recommend that whenever you make a new layer, you give it a name, because it makes it so much easier later, rather than just having layer 97. I wonder what the hell that was.
Especially if this gets
complex.
You can just
go to the one with a name.
Especially
exactly.
If you get a, yeah.
And as your montages go on, they get more and more complex, then it just helps you to find your way around. So we've got this this new layer. We can fill this with white. I'm going to show you another shortcut here. The default colors here, as you can see, are black foreground and white in the background. If you do Alt-Delete, it fills any selection with the foreground color. I'll undo that. If you do Command or Control-Delete, then it fills the selection with the background color. Again, a very useful shortcut. I've seen people going up and getting the paint bucket tool to fill selections. This is a much, much easier way.
Yes.
So let me deselect that. I'm going to add a little shading on here, and I'll go for the burn tool. To highlights, and I'm going to make it a little smaller. Now, making a brush bigger and smaller, well, you can either go to the brushes panel and you can make it, you can choose a brush like this, and you can pick one. That's the long-winded way of doing it. You can use the square bracket keys to make a brush bigger and smaller. So here it is getting smaller with the left bracket, and there it is getting bigger with the right bracket. Can you see that happening?
Yeah, we're just catching up to it. It's a little behind your speech.
Up.
Yeah, there we
okay.
go.
Okay. Well, I'll try and speak before I act. Here we go. So I'm going to add a little shading around the outside of this eye just to give it a bit of a three-dimensional appearance.
So you're just basically shading on pure white.
Stop it looking quite so flat.
It's just the pure white
there,
fill
so
that you're
there's
shading
a right. very rough sense of those eyeballs. Because we worked with white eyes and then added the black shading, what we're actually getting is a very gray appearance. So we need to add a little color to this. There are lots of ways we can add color in Photoshop, as you know. I find for this color balance is probably the simplest way. So we'll put in a little bit of red and a little bit of yellow just to bring some color into Gordon's eyes there.
Just using the mid-tone?
Are you seeing this okay?
Yes. You're just using the mid-tones here?
Oh, Doug, you vanished. You still there?
Have I gone?
Oh, yes. No, sorry, my headphones came. I should explain that I'm...
Don't scare me like
I'm
that.
I'm sitting here wearing two sets of headphones because of bizarre technical reasons. Anyway, there we go. So there's his eyes. So let's now get a pupil to go in here. And I never travel out without one of these. So let's get our eyeball.
Pupils? Oh,
bring
okay.
It in. Iris, actually. It's the iris, isn't it?
Okay, so you just have like one that you use generically and then alter it.
I have one multi-purpose iris, and I use it for everything. So we can drag this into our document there. Okay, way too big. So we'll use free transform.
I like that.
And scale that down. That's about the right kind of size. And let's take a copy of that and put it in the other eye. To make a copy, you just hold the Alt key down as you start to drag. Now, the problem we've got here is that let's give it a name, the iris layer is sitting above the eyeball layer, but it's not part of it. What we want to do is to make a clipping mask with the eyeball layer so that it only shows up where the two overlap. And we can do that by doing layer and create clipping mask, or we could use the shortcut Alt-Command-G or Alt-Control-G. And now what we've got is the iris using that eyeball as a clipping mask. So as we move it around, it only shows up where it overlaps that layer underneath.
Very Terry Gilliam.
Terry Gilliam right inside Photoshop. Now, so we've got the eyes in the right place, and you know we can have those looking in any direction, and it looks fairly convincing. Gordon, as I think, yes, he had brown eyes and not blue eyes, so let's just fix the color of those eyes. We can use hue and saturation and just change to that brown, maybe look a little darker. There we go. There's a slight white fringe around the edge, and that's because the iris is sitting straight on top of the eyeball, and what we want to do is to pick up the shading that we applied to the eyeball. And the simplest way of doing this is to change the mode, the light mode of this layer from normal to multiply. And what will now happen is that these irises will darken up what's underneath. There we go. Oh, and as we move it around the eye, that
very
shading
nice.
Comes through, and we can see that on the eye itself.
You just snapped right in. That looks really nice.
It works, doesn't it? Okay, so multiply is a very useful light mode, and what that does is it darkens up the layer with the layer that's underneath it, multiplying their values together. And the opposite of multiply is screen. There's a special light mode that I want to show you, which is called hard light. And I think the easiest way I can show you this is by maybe drawing a beard onto Gordon Brown. Let's give him a bit of an unshaven look. So I'm going to go for the brush tool, slightly bigger. Oh, this is a nice trick in CS4. If you hold the Alt and Control keys down, that's on a Mac. I don't know what you'd hold on the PC.
It is Alt Control on the PC. It's
Alt Control. Okay, there as well. We can now drag the brush, and we can make this any size we want simply by dragging it. Very, very nice feature.
I do like that feature.
So what I'm going to do, it's great, isn't it? I'm going to go to my swatches palette, and I'm going to pick a mid-gray tone. And I'm going to paint, I'm going to first of all make a new layer and give it a name. This thing about giving layers names is something that I always tell people to do, and you know I always forget to do it myself.
Oh, sure.
So do what I say and not what I do. Here we go. Let's paint on here. I'm going to start off painting a rough beard area. So over the lip and under the chin, and then gradually paint it back up towards the hairline.
It's not looking so good
there
so far.
Is a very Oh, Doug, I thought you were a fan. There we go. So there's the beginnings of our beard. We want to get some texture into this beard. And the easiest way of building texture in here, well, let's start off with some noise. So we'll go to Filter, Noise, Add Noise, and that's not bad. Okay, so we've got some Gaussian monochromatic noise. Monochromatic, because we don't want loads of colors in there. That would just look silly. So monochromatic, just black and white noise. Now, there's the beginning of the texture there. The thing about hair is that it doesn't sit flat on the face. It radiates out from the face. So let's make this radiate. We'll go for the marquee tool and make a selection that's centered on the bridge of his nose. Now, by holding the Alt key down before I start to draw this selection, I can draw it from the center out. And that's a very useful thing to remember, that you can control the way you draw something if you hold a modifier key down first. The Alt key lets you draw from the center out, very useful when drawing ellipses, for example, or circles. And the reason I've done that is because I'm now going to go to Filter, Blur, and Radial Blur. And what Radial Blur will do is it will is to spin here, change it to zoom. It'll push the pixels out from the center. So it's important that you get the center in the right place.
So the marquee selection determines the center of the radial blur.
That's right. If I'd simply made a selection of the whole image, then the center would be somewhere on his cheek, maybe, and the hair would look like it's going in the wrong direction. So I'm going to go for amount of 5, quite a small amount, change it to zoom, and let's go for best quality. Hey, why not? What have we got to lose? Only some pixels. And press OK. And what we have now is the beginnings of the sense of hair.
Yeah.
Can you see how it appears to be radiating from the bridge of the nose there?
It's a very large improvement.
Okay.
Got a Castro look.
A large improvement. What we're going to do is change the mode of this now from normal to hard light. And what hard light does is it's a special mode where mid-tones disappear, they're invisible. And it's only the highlights and the shadows that we can see. So when I change to hard light, there we go. Now,
marvelous.
We have a beard that appears to sit on top of his face. We can use the dodge and burn tools again set to highlight, so we can darken it up if we want a bit more of a 5 o'clock shadow effect. Or this is a useful trick. When you're using the burn tool and you want to use the dodge tool temporarily, don't go over here and change it. Hold down the Alt key, and that will give you the other tool temporarily. This works with a few other tools, actually, and we'll talk about these later. So by doing this, I'm bringing a little bit of two flecks of white, flecks of gray into the beard.
Oh, this is excellent, yes.
And there we go. And quite a nice sense of having a beard. Let me just trim that up around the side of his face there.
I didn't want to say anything.
And under there. That's fine. Okay, so, and it's the hard light mode that lets us do this. It lets us build whatever we want on top of the face, and only the highlights and the shadows come through. Let me show you one more example. I'm going to get rid of this as soon as I've done it, but let's say we want to maybe pour some treacle. You have treacle in the States? What do you call treacle? Molasses?
It's molasses syrup, anything along those lines.
Syrup, yeah. That kind of thing.
Caramel.
Well, let's pour something. Caramel, any kind of gooey substance that we're going to pour on top of his head. I'm going to make a new layer, and I'll call it goo, because it's up to us what kind of goo it is. And I'm going to go for the brush tool again. This time I'm going to use a hard-edged brush. Make it a little bigger, and again with that mid-tone gray, and I'm going to just paint on top of the head as if there's a big splatter of goo. Maybe have some rolling down his face like this.
Now the gray is for the blending later on, or just to visualization, or white gray?
The gray is like a substrate layer. I know that when I change to hard light mode, I can do it now. Change this layer to hard light mode, that gray will disappear completely. In fact, because it's a slightly dark gray, it hasn't quite disappeared. We can use curves to lighten that up slightly. There we go. That is now absolutely 50% gray,
yeah, okay.
And that's why it goes completely invisible. So we'll change this back to normal. What I'm now going to do is use the burn tool to add a little shading around the edge of this. Stuff roughly around the edge, and the dodge tool, remember we can use this by holding the Alt key down to put a few highlights in here. And now we're going to use my absolute favorite filter, which is filter, artistic, and plastic wrap. And you might think, how often do you want to wrap something in plastic? And the answer is never. I've never yet had to wrap something in plastic. But what the plastic wrap filter does is it enables things to look like a liquid.
It's wet.
Make it look like it's wet, exactly. If this is going to come up, there we go. Okay, so in fact, I'm just going to accept the default settings on that. We could increase the detail. No, let's just go for it as it is. There's our basic shininess on here. You can see that on the bottom of this strip, there's no shininess on there, and there's none down here as well. So we might want to adjust those. So I'm going to say OK to that and apply it. And now I'm going to undo it. I'm going to use the dodge tool to put a little bit of light in there and a little bit of light in the bottom of these drips. And now Command F, Control F to run that filter again.
Just to fine tune it.
There we go. To fine tune it. And now we get a much more drippy effect down there. Here's what happens when we change the mode of this from normal to hard light. As I say, as before, the mid-tone gray disappears, and what we're now left with is the highlight and the shadow. So it looks like there's water on top of his head.
Or egg white or something.
Or egg white. We could open up color balance once more, and we can put in a load of yellow and a load of red. And now we're starting to get that sense of the treacle, of the molasses, the goo that's coming through. This is not something you're going to want to do every day, but the point is that using you are going to want to do this every day. Maybe you are. It's very often where you want to make a kind of shiny effect like this, and by using hard light mode, you can do the gray substrate, if you like, the underlying layer, where then all the gray disappears, and you can just use the highlight and shadow. So I'm going to put that goo away now.
I'll come in handy later.
You never know. I'll keep that for on the back burner. I hope it doesn't boil over. So let's take Gordon, and let's find a new body for him. So first of all, I'm going to take the beard, the iris, the eyeball, and the head layer.
The it isn't labeled.
Select all of those, and I'm going to make a new group out of all these. So I go to the layer menu and I choose new group from layers. And give it a name, and let's call it Gordon's Head. Fine. And all that does is it puts it all together into one group that is more manageable, and I can treat it all as one. So let's go and find a body for him. And here's one that I thought might be quite nice. You know, he gets a lot of flack, and I'm sure what he could really do with is a bit of a beach holiday. So here's a guy from the beach. And we can see if we can put Gordon onto this body. We can see there are going to be a few mismatches, and that's something that we'll try and correct as we go along to make it look more part of this body. So this comes from a royalty-free image library called Rubber Ball, and all the images are cutouts, as you can see, and they all come with clipping paths. We had a call earlier about clipping paths. So here's the path. We can click on that and turn that into a selection, Command or Control, and the Enter key, and right away we can make this into a selection. We've got a cutout object we can work with.
Now that clipping path, that's a feature of the stock photo website. Some do it, some don't.
That's most of the stock photo websites. In fact, I would say all of the stock photo websites, with the exception of the full montage, which is my stock photo website, which I'll talk about a little later on, use clipping paths because it's a very compact way of storing images. What they can't do is do hair very well, any sort of fiddly detail like that. So you can see this is the guy's original hair. The clipping path leaves it actually quite hard cut around the edges.
It's still not
better
bad,
than most? It's not bad. It's better than most. So let's get Gordon in here. We can drag the whole layer set either from the document or from the layers panel, and we can just bring that straight into our new document. And it's a perfect fit. I think we're done.
A Penny Kibble would like you to reiterate the name of that stock photo site.
Yes, the it's made by Rubber Ball. I think it's probably now part of Getty. I think everything is part of Getty now. It's a good selection of images. So let's take the picture of Gordon and we'll make him smaller. We can use Free Transform to do this. A little trick, I'm holding the Alt key down, which is why he's scaling from the center. We talked about holding the Alt key to draw from the center out. Exactly the same when using Free Transform.
Do you worry about proportional resizing?
Yes, of course. Sorry. To keep it proportional, if I just dragged it from the center, it would do this, and that's crazy. Holding the Shift key down keeps it proportional. So I've got Alt and Shift together. I'm going to move his head out to the side so I can compare it with the size of the original, and about there looks right for this image. So I can now put it back on top of him and hit Enter to commit to that transformation. Now, let's zoom in on this. Well, there's clearly a few problems here. First of all, he's a little pale. What I'm going to do, though, is make the body match Gordon's head rather than the other way around, because he's quite a pale guy. First of all, he comes from Scotland, where it rains even more than it rains in England. And frankly, these days, he's got a lot to be pale about. He's having a difficult time. So I'm going to go now to Layer 1, which I'm going to rename as Gordon's Body. There we go. And I'm going to try and make this match the colors of his face. There are, as I say, lots of ways that you can play around with color and brightness and contrast, and by far the most comprehensive is Curves, which is Image Adjustment and Curves. Command-M, Control-M is the shortcut for that. There is no easy way to remember M for Curves. You just have to remember M for
Now, I've noticed you're not using layer masks. That's what, to avoid complexity or just for speed?
I will use a layer mask absolutely to blend the head into the body.
That's my error. I'm in adjustment layer. It's not layer mask.
I'm not using an adjustment layer because I want to work directly onto this body. and I want the changes I make to be permanent. I will certainly use adjustment layers, and we'll talk about those a little later on.
Okay.
Yep. So let's first of all brighten this up by dragging the curve up. I'm starting off by clicking in the midpoint, because now if I drag above this, that midpoint stays fixed and we can increase the contrast. So there we go. The contrast now is closer to the contrast on Brown's head. The body that we're looking at is it's too red, and it's got the highlights of green in there we don't really want. And some of the times when you're working with curves, you have to almost think backwards. So rather than taking the red out, I'm going to put some blue into it, and that should make it match the face better. There we go, a bit more blue. And we get about somewhere like that. And I think that's going to be a pretty good match. Put a little bit of green in there as well. Okay, that's not bad. Let me just add a touch more contrast on here. And I think we've got a body that we can work with now. So if we compare before and after, that's how it was. And that's the new version.
Can you do that again slower, please?
Sure. By checking the preview button, we can see that's what the body was like before we applied the curves. And we can check the preview button again, and we can now see the new version of it. And we can see the new version is a much closer match for Gordon Brown's head.
You made that look terribly easy. So
it's terribly easy. Well, with practice.
Easy for you, yeah.
So I'm going to say okay to that one. Now, we've got to make Gordon's head fit that body better than it does. And I'm sure you'll agree, it's just not there yet. So we'll go to the head. And even though we're working on a layer group, we can add a layer mask to this. Let me just talk about why layer masks are so good. What we could do is open this up, go to the head layer, and use the eraser, and we can just simply erase the head, you know, where we don't want it. The trouble with erasing anything is when you erase, it's permanent. Once it's gone, it's gone. You can get it back, yeah, through reverting a document through histories, but you can't come back to it in an hour's time, or in 2 weeks' time, or in 6 months' time, and bring that back, because it's gone forever. A much better way is to use a layer mask. And we can do this from the top of the layers panel. We click the pop-up menu, and we can choose... we can't do it from there anymore. We do it from the rewind. We do it from the layer menu, and we can do layer mask. And we've got two options, reveal all and hide all. We're going to go for reveal all. We want to start with the whole layer, whole group visible, and then we'll paint out where we don't want it. There we go. We can see no difference because we've done reveal all. The difference comes when we trip to the paintbrush tool. Here, when we paint in black, it hides this layer. There it is gone. The difference is when we swap over and paint with white, then we reveal it again. And another shortcut, the X key, will swap between the foreground and the background colors.
I like to use the black blocks. That's how I remember which is doing it.
Black blocks. Yeah, okay, that's good. I just remember these things. It's two colors. You have to remember. It's really not that difficult. So I'm going to go here for a soft-edged brush, and I'm going to paint the bottom of Gordon's head there. And as you can see, this is starting to blend him much more closely into that body, and he now looks, well, actually, pretty much like he's sitting on top of it. I've taken out a bit too much chin there, but because it's not an eraser, because it's a layer mask, I can swap the colors over and now just paint it back in again.
So you just keep hitting the X key over and over and fine-tuning
just it. Just keep hitting the X key, exactly. One thing I'm going to do now is add some shading. You can see there's some dark shadow on the body here, and we could do with a bit of that on the side of Gordon's head. We also want to get a little bit of shadow under the chin. to make his head look more in place there. He has a shorter neck than the original man. So what I'm going to do is make a new layer. I'm going to hold the Command or Control key down and click on the thumbnail for the body. And what that does is it loads up this layer as a selection. And you can see it showing up there to the marching ants. I want to add the head. So what I can do is open up, go to his head, hold the Shift key down, because the Shift adds to your selection, keep the Command or Control key down, and click on that, and now it'll add that to the overall selection. And you should be able to see that now the head and the body are all one single selection.
Yes.
I'm going to make a new layer, and I'm going to use my old friend Hard Light Mode again. There we go. And I'm going to fill with hard light neutral color, 50% gray, as we talked about earlier. And we're going to see nothing at all. Inside Gordon, outside him, because there's no background, we're seeing the light coming out. So what I will do is inverse this selection. So now selecting everything except him and delete. Okay.
Okay.
What we have now is this hard light layer. If I change this to normal, that's how the layer really looks. When it's in hard light mode.
Okay, your audio is breaking up again. Whatever you did last time, do it again.
Okay, what I did was made a selection of his body and his head. Made a new layer. Set to hard light mode, and what we now have is hard light layer that exactly matches the head and the body together. Are you hearing me okay now?
Yeah, there's the same distortion we had earlier. I'm assuming it's a bandwidth problem or the fact that you're several thousand miles away.
It could be. I'm even further from New Zealand. I wonder how it's playing down there. Okay, I'll try talking slower. Do tell me if I'm breaking up an enormous.
It's getting better. It's drifting in and out. Everybody, okay. it's an intermittent thing. So just be patient.
Okay. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to use dodge and burn tools once again on this hard light layer, and I can add my shading. So I'm painting my shadow directly onto the hard light layer with the burn tool, and I can add a little bit underneath the chin there as well. And this is just unifying these layers and making them look more like they belong together. The advantage of doing it this way is that by working on the hard light layer, I'm not touching the original. I can always hide that if I want to, simply by turning that off. I'm working on a separate layer. And when you're doing photomontage work that involves several layers, you want to keep as much flexibility as you can. Okay, so now I'll tell you what I've done. I've left a bit of that head, the original head, visible behind. I'm just going to select that and delete it. I'm not going to make a layer mask here because I know I want that gone forever. And I'm going to do the same thing on our hard light layer. And I'm just going to rub this out. Actually, something I'll tell you never to do with the eraser tool. You didn't see that. Okay, we've now got Gordon with his new body, and he's looking reasonable on there, I think.
Very good.
He's looking a bit too reasonable, actually. I think he's getting on a bit. I don't think he works out. We need to maybe make this body perhaps match Gordon a little better than it does. So let's take this and let's go into another of my favorite filters, which is Liquify. And Liquify allows us to push pixels around in a fairly major way. So there is our body. We can go down here to show backdrop, and we can say use just Gordon's head. Let's go for that one by itself.
This is why you named the layers.
This is why I named the layers. And it should be showing it. Now, why is it filling that with white? Okay, let's not show the backdrop. Let's just work with this as it is. We want to, we need a bit of a paunch on there. So we can make the brush tool bigger. And again, the square bracket keys you can use to make a brush bigger and smaller in here. If you hold the shift key, it makes it bigger and smaller, bigger jumps. Otherwise,
we have a question from Lonnie Kramer that wants to know if you use a tablet or if you're using a mouse.
I use a tablet. I strongly recommend using a tablet. You get much more control, particularly when doing things like shading or painting. You have far more control over what you're doing. For those of you who don't yet have a tablet, one word of warning: if you buy a tablet, for the first 2 weeks, you will hate it.
Yes.
Yes. Get one, stick with it. After 2 weeks, it'll suddenly click, and you'll suddenly know what you're doing.
You won't know how you did without one.
Exactly. You can't go back. I use the smallest Wacom tablet I can get. It's an A6 version. It's the cheapest one they make.
It's 4x5 here in the United States.
Yeah, it's fantastic. So here I'm going to just bulk up his chest a bit, give him a bit of a belly on there, and maybe just make his arms a little thicker, a bit more sagging generally, I think, so that it suits Gordon's body rather better. There we go. This is a very good tool as well for adjusting expressions. So if you get a picture of someone who needs to be smiling or needs to frown, it can be done very, very easily with the liquify tool. I love it. Very good fun to play with. There we go. Let's say OK to that. And there's a Gordon on a slightly more appropriate body for a man of his age. Let's put all of these together and make a new group out of these. So new group from layers, and we can call this one Gordon Full. There we go. What we're going to do now is to find a location to put him in. I'm going to put the original head away. So let's go back into Bridge. And this is quite cute. So here we have a rather attractive French chateau. Let's zoom in on this slightly. And we want to stick Gordon into this picture. So let's take this whole group, Gordon Full, and we can simply drag him in. We'll make him smaller, and I think that might be the right kind of size. Yep.
Yeah, but we have a question from Catherine Gomez concerning sure. How you, when you're resizing parts, or like now when you're resizing into the image here, do you try for accuracy, or do you go mostly by eyeball? Do you deliberately make, like, for example, would you choose a head size more for humor or realism?
It depends on the purpose. If I'm aiming for realism, I'll try and get the head size as accurate as possible. For something like this, we're going for a bit more humor. So you make the head slightly bigger. You would make the irises slightly too big. It'd exaggerate, as I have done here, the body. So for placing him in the situation, yeah, I'll make his body slightly bigger than it really should be, I think.
Have an interesting question from Anthony Tor. From Anthony T, and he wants to know if I'm paraphrasing here a little bit. Pardon me, Anthony. Less realistic funnier, or do you go for more realism in certain circumstances, or do you deliberately leave it with more of a photoshopped look again for humor? This is related to the previous question.
Yeah, that's a very good question. It depends what I'm doing. A lot of what I do is sort of very straightforward retouching work, where I'll try to make things look as realistic as possible. So, for the example, with the Radio Times illustration, the Top Gear one we showed earlier, I was trying to make that look as realistic as possible. When I'm doing satirical work for newspapers, I think it's quite important to make people realize, actually, this is an illustration.
So you want to underscore it.
Exactly. You know, Vladimir Putin is not really riding a hydrogen bomb. This is just a picture, and it's a cartoon, if you like.
Caricature.
There have been times when I've done illustrations in newspapers, and I've made them too realistic, and I've looked at them printed, and I thought, actually, that is giving a misleading impression. So sometimes I try and exaggerate it to make it look hyper-real, if you like. So that people are aware that what they're looking at, particularly a newspaper, they have to be, I think, aware that this is not real life. So what I'm going to do in here is place Gordon behind this fence. And the way I'm going to do that is, again, using a layer mask. So I'm going to go to layer, layer mask, and actually, no, I'm going to do it another way around. First of all, I'm going to lower the opacity on Gordon so we can see the background behind him. So there he is, just about visible in there, but we can clearly see the fence and the wall behind. I'm going to go to the background and select the magic wand tool, and I'm going to click on one of these fence posts. If we add the shift key down, then we add to our selection. So I'm clicking on each of these in turn, and it's loading them all up as a selection, as you can see.
You're using a very low tolerance, I noticed.
I'm using a tolerance of 32, that's right. I would rather click several times than have too high a tolerance and then have to deselect. So there's the all of that fence actually very quickly selected. And I'm going to add the wall, this time using the lasso tool. Now, one of the clear things about your lasso tool is you can make it behave like a polygonal lasso. First of all, because I want to add to the existing selection, I need to hold the shift key down before I start. And you can see the little plus that comes up next to the lasso.
Yes,
that indicates that I'm going to be adding to my selection. So I can drag, and it's going to be tricky to drag around these shapes. So what I'm going to do is hold the Alt key down. And what that does is temporarily give me the polygonal lasso tool. So I can go and click and click and click and go along the bottom of this, top of this wall, and then right around the bottom of the document and back up the side of the fence like that. Okay, and there is the wall and the fence all selected. So I can now bring Gordon's group back to his full opacity. And this time, I'm going to go to the layer menu and do layer, layer mask, hide selection, because I want him behind this fence that I've selected. There we go. And now we've got this layer mask built, and there is Gordon behind the layer mask. And we can put him where we want, except, oh, there's a problem. The problem is, the layer mask is moving with the layer, or with, in this case, with the group. Let me undo that. And the reason it's moving is because this little icon between the group and the mask, you see this little chain here?
The link.
If we click on that, it disappears. And we can now go back to the layer, and now, as we move the layer around, the mask stays where it is. Now, I think this is actually pretty cool because we've got Gordon Brown now simultaneously in front of and behind the background. We've not made a new layer from this fence. We've simply made the mask from it, so we can move him around behind it, and you can see how well he moves behind this. And that all comes from having the layer mask that is not linked to his layer. Does this make sense? Do we have any questions about this?
Not so far.
No? Good. Okay, let's make him a little bit smaller. Again, I can change his scale, anything I want, and the mask stays exactly where it is. Let's put a firework up in the sky, because he's on holiday now. He's down in rural France. He can leave politics behind him, and he's been having a bit of fun there. So let's go back into Bridge, and we can open up. There we go, firework. Fireworks, by the way, make terrific explosions, and I use them for all kinds of things. So we'll drag this in. Okay. Well, it doesn't look too good. We've got to get rid of all that black background. Now, I don't know if any of our viewers want to suggest ways in which we can do that. I'm sure there are several ways we can remove the background. Do we have any questions coming in? Any people with suggestions on this?
Let's see here. Joshua says screen mode.
Ah, good idea. Okay. Let's change the mode from normal to screen. Now, as we talked about, screen will certainly get rid of all that black. The trouble is, it almost gets rid of all the white as well, because if we move the firework down over the bush there, it's just about visible. But back over the clouds, we really can't see that at all. So I don't think, unfortunately, screen mode is going to work.
I'm getting a flood of people saying blend if.
Ahaha, absolutely, blend if. They must be reading my book. Blend if is terrific. For the people who don't know about blend if, this is going to absolutely knock you out. What you do is you double-click the layer, and it brings up the layer style dialog. And it's this section at the bottom, blend if. This controls the visibility of the layer depending on how bright or how dark it is. So if I grab this triangle and move this to the right, there we go. All that black starts to disappear. In this case, anything darker than, here we go, this value of 12 will disappear. The problem is, if we zoom in on this firework and we look at the edge, we can see it looks very pixelated. We have a very hard cutoff between what's visible and what's hidden. And the trick to that is hold the Alt key down. This Alt key has so many uses in Photoshop. And click on this black triangle. And that will separate it into two. And we can drag the right one independently of the left one. What now happens is everything darker than this value of 35 is hidden. Everything brighter than this value of 62 is fully visible. And everything in between fades smoothly into view. So let's say OK to that, and we can zoom out and see how that works. OK, we've now got our full strength firework, and we can see right through it. And that works pretty well. But let's say, OK, we've got the firework here. Actually, it wants to be more in the distance. We want to put it behind, certainly behind this tower, maybe behind the hedge, and maybe behind that electricity pylon as well. How can we do that? Well, in exactly the same way. We'll bring up our layer style dialog again. This time, in the blend if section, we can look not at the this layer, which controls the firework layer, but underlying layer. This, remember, we're working on the firework layer. This will control the visibility of the firework layer depending on what's beneath it. So once again, we can drag this triangle to the right. And as we do so, you should be able to see the shadow, there we go, starting to come in front. And if we go far enough, we can now see the electricity lines coming in front of this. Once again, we can split this into two by holding the Alt key down. This just softens the edge in this case. So if I say OK to this, we now have a firework. We can move around. We can move it behind the hedge. We can move it behind this very complex object up in the sky there. And without doing any erasing, without adding a layer mask, without having to paint on the object in any way, we've managed to push it right into the background. And I find this such a useful thing to be able to do. There are many, many occasions in which we can make this work for us. And I really like the way this works. However, let's say, okay, the fireworks all very well. Let's put a more dramatic sky in here. I'm going to get rid of the firework for now.
Well, before you move on to the firework, yeah? Joshua would like to know if that technique is explained in more detail in any of your books.
Yes, this technique is explained in some detail in How to Cheat in Photoshop. Thank you for mentioning that, Josh. And that gives me an excuse to do this, which my publisher insists I do every... I'm supposed to be able to do it for 15 minutes, but I'm very slack. Yeah, so I'm told. Anyway, there it goes. All done. It is explained in the book, and there are several examples showing how this works. But actually, really, you can learn a lot about this by just experimenting with it. It's the kind of thing you cannot break anything. Anything you do, look, we can open up the dialog again, and we can undo it. So we can drag those all the way out, and there we go. That's now in front of the pylon. We can drag these back, and now all that black background comes back. Everything we do, we can then undo. So experiment as much as you like. You cannot injure your artwork in this way. I'm going to cancel these changes to revert to how that was. Let's put this away. Let's say, actually, what we want to do is to erase this sky, and we want to replace this with a more dramatic sky. Let's look at how to do this, because it's something we have to do quite a lot in Photoshop. First of all, I'm going to double-click this background to make a new layer out of it. And I'll still call it background, because it is the background of our image, but I'm going to want to erase parts out of it. You cannot make something a background layer transparent.
With the word background in italics at that point.
With the word background in italics, I should maybe call this, us call it shadow, just to make it easy. So the next step, because I'm going to be doing some erasing here, not using a layer mask, but I'm going to be erasing directly on the image, I'm going to start by adding a history point. So I'm going to click in the history palette just by the current step. Now, you know the way that the history palette works is it lets you move backwards and forwards between every stage in your artwork. There we go. That goes up and down like this. There are more uses of this, and we'll come onto this very shortly. For now, we're just going to pin in that point, so clicking next to the current stage of the artwork in the history palette, which we can now put away. I'm now going to go for the eraser tool, but rather than the regular eraser, we're going to use the background eraser tool, and this is a very, very clever tool. This is covered in some detail in my book. I'm not going to talk endlessly about it now, but I'm going to set this to sample once and to behave in a discontiguous way.
Well, we did get a question about that. They wanted to know, you were showing two books, and they wanted to know which book, and I'll just tell everybody that he's talking about is How to Cheat in Photoshop book.
Sorry, How to Cheat in Photoshop. The other book, Art and Design in Photoshop, is a book about the design process. It's a book about how to design, how to fake, if you like, parodies of book covers and film posters and artist styles from Van Gogh to Andy Warhol. That's all taken care of in there. I'm talking about How to Cheat in Photoshop. When I say the book, I mean the book, as far as I'm concerned. Okay, here we go. Let's erase some of this background. The way this works is, we click on a color with the Alt key held down. That gives us the eyedropper tool, and that sets that color as the foreground color, which we can see down in the corner. The point that's underneath the crosshairs in the middle of the eraser is the first point that's sampled, and it will erase, here we go, that range of colors, and you can see that going. It will not erase the foreground color, because we've held it up here, protect the foreground color. And we can carry on erasing through here, and we can go down the other side. Okay, and as we get to work with the bush here, well, I can sample this as my foreground color, and that is now the color that will not be erased. And let's carry on and go all the way around this image. And you can see how the background eraser tool looks right inside these images, and how it's able to take out this really very complex object, removing all the sky from that. And now we can drop our new sky in place. But, well, I'll have to check that it's taken it all out. Let's make a new layer with a solid color. Let's go for, say, a blue. Make a new layer.
If I could pause you here for a second,
yeah,
to address some questions that are coming in. The background eraser is a destructive tool. Clear?
It is a destructive tool, exactly. And that is why I set the history. And I'll show you why I did that, well, right now. I'm going to make a new layer and fill this with solid blue, which I'm going to move behind our shadow. In fact, let's change this to maybe a darker color, like a purple. Now we can see where we've missed pieces that we were trying to erase. We can go back to that shadow, and now we can get all those extra bits of sky that just weren't picked up on the first pass. This is quite a useful technique to always make this.
You just enhance the contrast by using a contrasting color.
That's right. This is simply so I can see where I've erased the sky and where I've missed. Okay, so there the sky completely gone. But we can see a problem. Well, part of the power cable box has been erased by accident. And also, the side of the shadow here has been erased. And I think up here, yep, the top here has also been erased. And we could undo and undo and undo. But what we can do instead is go for the history brush. I'm going to set this with a hard brush. And if you remember, before we started doing any erasing, we pin the history at that point. That's where it is. That's the thing that the history brush will refer to. These are all our deleting steps afterwards. What that means is, when I paint with the history brush, it's now painting the state of the artwork back in as it was at that point when we pinned it on the history. So rather than doing any complex undoing or trying to rebuild the inadvertently erased parts of the image, we can go back and very easily just paint these back in again using this history brush. You know, when the history brush first came out, I think it was in Photoshop 7, as I recall.
But sounds right.
I remember this better than I do. And I thought, yeah, okay, this is just for people who, you know, who can't get it right the first time. It's way more useful than that. It allows you to revert parts of your image selectively. So there we go. All those bits that were taken out by accident, we can now paint right back in using this history brush. This is a fantastic tool. We can see now there's a bit of a fringe around. Is that showing up on your screen, Doug? You can see that okay?
And by the way, it was Photoshop 5. Just had an expert friend mention that it was Photoshop 5.
Wow, you've got some real experts out there.
I think he's a friend
Most
of yours.
Most impressive. Okay. Oh, good. Okay. So let's get rid of this fringe now. We could try the defringe command, but I don't think it's going to do that too well. So let's cheat on this one. We'll lock the transparency, and I'll show you how that makes a difference. If I switch to the brush tool, pick a nice bright color, and I just paint on there, it'll paint as we'd expect over the whole image. If we lock the transparency of the layer by clicking this little icon at the top of the layers palette, lock transparent pixels, now the brush only shows up, any painting we do only shows up where there are already pixels in this layer. And the reason we want to do that is because I'm going to go for the clone tool, sample a point just inland of the fringe, but also on part of the roof. And now as I drag this tool up the roof, you can see it covers up all those tiles with
a reasonably
convincing match. It works pretty well. And it's just, you know, so much of the work I do in Photoshop is about trying to find faster ways of doing things.
And anything with composites or montaging is basically eventually going to boil down to hiding the seams.
Exactly. As I move over here, look, we can see, oh, there's a bit of that roof line that I forgot to bring back in. No matter. We can use the history brush again, remembering to uncheck that lock transparency, and then we can paint that back in. There we go. So at any point, we can use the history brush to revert to that earlier state of the artwork. Okay, so here's our picture. Let's try a new sky in here. We can go for, say, a nice blue sky. Where did that one go? There we go. And we can simply drag this in place, move it behind our shadow, and there we go. And it looks actually pretty good in there. You know, we can see, because we've used the background eraser tool, we were able to erase around all these very fine cables up in the sky. Would have been very hard to select those by any other method. But actually, let's say, well, rather than having a nice blue sky, let's go for more of an evening sky. It's more dramatic. It will look more imposing. Maybe even something as dark as this sky here. So we'll drag this into place. I like that. I like that very much. Yes, that's a nice, dark, brooding sky. Well, the problem we have now, of course, is that we've got this dark evening sky, but we're working with a very bright, sunlit day. So we need to find some way now to turn the image from daytime into nighttime. So let's go to our shadow layer. And the way to do this is by using those adjustment layers that we talked about briefly earlier on. Adjustment layers work just the same as any normal adjustment, except they are as if they're on a separate layer floating above the layer that we're working on. So we can go down to the bottom here, adjustments, and once again, I'm going to choose curves. And as I drag down on the curve, you can see this darkens up the whole thing. The trouble is, it's also darkening up the sky behind. And the sky behind is already dark enough. I don't want that to be any darker than it is. I want this adjustment only to apply to our shadow layer. The way to do that is to click on the tool at the bottom of the panel here that effectively forms a clipping group with the layer beneath. As I click on that, there we go. It now only applies to the shadow layer and not to the cloud layer behind. One thing that was worth pointing out is that this adjustment is applying itself obviously to this piece of fence and the wall that's in front of Gordon Brown there. If we'd made a new layer out of this and brought this to the front, it wouldn't apply to that. It's not applying to Gordon because even though he's behind the fence and therefore should really be behind the adjustment layer, he's being hidden by the layer mask. And that's what makes this work so well. So we've darkened this up. Let's add a little blue here to give it more of a nighttime flavor. There we go. Maybe take some of the red out of this. I'm going to pull this way down, I think. Maybe take a little bit of green out of it too. And perhaps a touch more blue. Oh, no, I'll put some of that green back in. Okay, so we get the sense of a nighttime feel. I'm going to make this fraction darker. There we go. And take a little. So we're getting the beginnings of a nighttime feel to this. And it certainly does match the background better, but in order to really make it look like night, we need to maybe put a light on in one of these windows, because I think the contrast between a lit-up window and the dark background will be quite dramatic. So let's zoom in on here. I'm going to select this window using the lasso tool again. So first of all, I'll select the outside. So click, I'm holding the Alt key down so I get the polygonal lasso. And I go to this corner and click down to the bottom and click over to this corner. And that's going to wiggle up around this uneven stonework and click all the way around this. And there is the basic window selected. I want to remove the frame from this selection. So to remove from a selection, you hold the Alt key down before you start to draw. And if I move it over the cursor over a dark area, when I press the Alt key now, you can see the little minus sign appearing next to the lasso.
Right.
That means we're going to subtract from our selection. So I can start to draw. Now that I've started, I can release the Alt key. And now I need to press it again so I can get straight lines. So I'm going to go down there and up. Okay. So the Alt key performing two functions here. Firstly, you hold it before you start to draw to subtract from your selection. Hold it again after you start to draw to with the lasso tool to make it behave like the polygonal lasso tool. And I'll do the same here to get rid of these bars in the window. One, two, and the same for the ones at the bottom. So now we have a selection that matches the panes in this window. And I'm going to hide the edges on here. It's still the selection. We no longer see the shimmering edges. Now, one of the cool things about making a layer mask, about an adjustment layer rather, is that it comes by default with its own built-in layer mask. So if, because black is the background color, all I do is simply press delete, and that area is removed from the mask. Actually, we can make that a little bit brighter. Let's add another adjustment layer. When we click on the adjustment layer icon, it opens the adjustment layer we've already on. It thinks we want to work on that one. We don't, so we'll press this arrow to go back to our selection list. And this time, let's maybe make a levels adjustment. We could use curves again, but levels just for the sake of change. We want to brighten this up and go to the red channel, add a bit of red in this, green channel. And you'll notice that this time, the mask for this adjustment layer is the inverse of the mask for the previous one. Because I still had a selection active, the adjustment only happens, only applies to that selected area. Let's zoom out.
You just hit that selection just so it didn't distract you?
Say again, sorry?
The control H just so you could work uninterrupted?
Exactly. I knew the selection was there, but I wanted to see the effect without those marching ants' borders. So I hit that. Okay, so there is a montage coming on now with the lit-up window, which gives kind of a focus to the nighttime scene. In fact, I'm going to adjust this adjustment layer here, and I think make it even darker. I'm going to take out a little bit more red and blue down reflection and the green just to make it darker still.
Our audio is drifting out again. Apologies to people, but be patient. It'll come back in a minute or two.
Okay.
Actually, a Dalek is exactly what you sound like.
Well, maybe that's not something you're using Photoshop. You know, you said that you said all day long. It's bound to happen, isn't it?
Can you say exterminate a few times for me?
Exterminate.
There you go.
This is horrifying. Okay. Is it sounding really bad, or can we...
It's getting better. It's getting better. The bandwidth is clearing up.
Okay. I'm going to bring a light in here. I've got a street lamp. And here's a nice lamppost, so let's open this up, and I'll drag this into place. And there it is. Yeah, right in front of our montage. That's pretty good in there. I like that one. Except there's a problem. We're looking way up. You can see the angle we're looking at the top of this light, and that needs to be much higher in the scene than it is now. It's far too low, really. So let's go to the perspective of it. Yeah, we're the angle we're looking at it, that needs to be really right up here. But at the same time, the base needs to be right down there. So I think, okay, how can we do that? Well, we can use free transform again, and we can just make it taller. Well, actually, that's not very good. The proportions are going all wrong. You know, the lantern is too tall now. These crossbars, they look too stubby. The whole thing just looks completely wrong. And if we were going to make this smaller, oh, that'd be awful. Look how that's looking so compressed. Very, very ugly. We can't do it that way. Fortunately, for those who have Photoshop CS4, can you all put up your hands if you have CS4? Oh, yeah, well, quite a lot of you. Okay, that's good. For those who don't, this is a really, really cool thing in Photoshop CS4. We can go to Edit and Content-Aware Scale. Now, I know if you have CS4, if you've read about it, you would have seen this in action on landscapes. It does a great job on landscapes. But for a montage artist, it's fantastic on cutout objects. What we can do now with this lamppost is if I make it smaller, you can see the shaft of the post is getting smaller, but the key elements, the lantern, the crossbar, the decoration at the bottom, they are still remaining intact. Again, we can make this bigger, and you can see how all the key parts of this lamppost are getting taller, getting further apart, but the thing itself is not distorting. There we go. Let's put it up like that. For those of you who have not experimented using context-aware scaling on cutout objects, it can work fantastically, very, very useful, perhaps even more useful than using it on landscapes.
And you have to hand it to Adobe for not calling it magic scale.
There's our lamppost. Much better. Put it in place. Am I intelligible, Doug? Am I audible?
You're sounding good. I'm wondering if your headphones have slipped off and you can't hear me anymore.
Yep, no, sorry, but I can hear you now. You were cut out for a bit. Well, sorry, were you saying something? Did I miss anything there?
Nothing important, trust me.
You could have been saying anything. I couldn't have heard you. Sorry, my headphone jack slipped out. Okay, we have the lamppost in place, and this content-aware scaling is fantastic. I really like it so much. I want to light up this lamppost. First of all, actually, let's give it a name. Because I've told you always to do that. Lamppost. Let's make a new layer. We can call it light. And, you know, it's the kind of thing you can agonize over. How do you best make a light inside here? And the answer is actually, it is very, very straightforward. You go for a brush tool, you go for some pale yellow, and you simply paint in yellow. And then you go for a slightly smaller brush, and you go for white and you add a bit of white in the middle. And actually, that's all there is to it, and you can make what's really quite a convincing light out of this.
Yes, it is.
So it works okay, doesn't it? There's our lamp. Clearly, it's lighting up the scene, or rather, it's not lighting up the scene because it should be casting some light on this gate over here, maybe some on the ground down there, certainly on the wall over here. So how do we let some light into this? Well, the simple way is to go back to the adjustment layer, that's this one here, the adjustment layer that applies to our shadow layer. Let's just zoom in on this a little bit. And if we remember that the adjustment layer comes with a mask, if we paint on this mask, we're going to hide the effect of the adjustment layer. So I can paint out, there we go, on the fence, a little bit on the ground here, a little bit on the wall and the fence behind. And I'm not painting with a color, I'm simply painting the effect out on the adjustment layer. And if you look at how well it lets the light into this path and onto the gate, you know, that's really quite a convincing way of making it look as if it's lit up from this lamp at the top.
Now, since you're using the tablet, you've got pressure aware on there, so it's going to vary that, right?
That's right. If I was using the mouse, then I would use the brush tool and I would set the opacity to maybe 10%. Tip here, you can change the opacity by going up here and dragging the slider. Actually, that takes quite a long time to do. Or you can go in here and you can retype, there you go, 10% return. That takes even longer. A far quicker way is with the brush tool selected is hit any of the number keys. So if I press 4, if I press 4,
live
I get
broadcast,
40%.
Folks.
If I press 6, I get 60%. If I press 0, I get 100%. And if you press 2 in rapid succession, so if I say 50%, that's a bit too much, I want 45, I can do 4 and 5 together, and that gives me 45%. Very useful when using the brush tool, certainly, especially if you don't have a pressure-sensitive tablet, but also when you want to change the opacity of a layer. So if I change to say the move tool or any of the selection tools. Now I'm on the adjustment layer. If I now press the number keys, you can see the opacity of the layer. You can see over here on the layers panel, 5 will give us 50% opacity, 7 gives us 70% opacity, 0 up to 100% opacity. It's a very, very easy way and very quick way to be able to change the opacity of a layer or the strength of a brush without actually having to go for a slider or use the other techniques. And I could really recommend this. This is a good way of working. Let's take Gordon now. And I'm going to move him in front of this fence because I think I'd like to have him standing a bit closer to the light. So I'm going to disable the layer mask. I might want it later, so I'm not going to delete it. Instead, I hold the Shift key down and click on it, and now that layer mask is disabled. So he now appears to be standing in front. We need to adjust his lighting so that it matches the lighting of the scene. Well, fortunately, we can do that using this layer that we made earlier, the one that I failed to give a name to, which was the hard light layer. Now, you remember that we made this hard light layer in order to add the shading on the side of his face. We can make use of it here again to add some more general shading onto him. Let me zoom in on this picture. If I hold the Command or Control key down and click on here, you can see the selection is curiously not quite matching. I don't know what's going on there. That's interesting. There we go. That's very strange. I'm going to make a new hard light layer because the old one was working with the undistorted version of the body rather than the distorted version. As you say, hey, it's live, folks. There we go. These things happen.
That's why you hadn't renamed it.
Exactly. So I'm going to make a new layer now, and I'm going to call this one New Hard Light Layer. Good. Yes, I gave it a name because I always give names to my layers when I create them. And I'm going to go for Mode Hard Light. Fill with our hard light neutral color. What I want to do now is I want to paint on this layer, but I don't want the I only want the paint to show up where it overlaps Gordon. What I can't do is make a clipping mask with the layers beneath because his head and his body are on separate layers that don't match. So what I'm going to do is inverse our selection using Shift-Command-I up there, and now delete. So what we've now got is this hard light layer that precisely matches the shape of the head and the body. And this time I'm going to lock the transparency. So any painting takes place only within this area. I'll switch to the brush tool, got a big brush, and I want to add some shadows. So I'm going to sample some color out of the image. I'm going to take, say, some of this blue color from this fence post, because I know that is our nighttime blue. The gate is white. The blue makes it look like it's at night, so that's the color that we want to add on here. And as I paint on top of this hard light layer, you can see how this blue will add the night effect onto this body. Of course, he is lit up from the lamp up there, so let's sample some yellow out of the lamp and paint some of this on the other side, and that gives us the lighting that comes from the lamp onto the side of his face, onto his shoulder, making him look much more part of this scene. This is a really useful thing to be able to do, to be able to paint on the hard light layer like this, because the gray of the hard light disappears. It's only the colors that we add that affect what's underneath it. And we can go back at any time and adjust this, erase it, paint over it, and we are never damaging the original layers underneath. If I hide this, the original body is still there and intact. It's only the hard light layer that gives us the shading. Let's switch now to the burn tool and darken up just the back to make that really in deeper shadow. So now he's much more lit from that light coming above him. Of course, a light up there would cast a shadow on the fence behind us, so let's make a shadow. Very easily done. We can hold Command or Control and click on our hard light layer, and that loads up Gordon Brown with his head, with the body, as a selection. If we now go down to a layer just below Gordon's body, we can now make a new layer, and we'll call this one Shadow. Let's feather this slightly. So select, modify, and feather. And we'll feather this by, say, 3 pixels. So all that's doing is softening up the edge. The D key will change the foreground color to black. Alt-Delete will fill our selection with black. We can't see it because it's behind the body, but if we move it out to the side, there is our shadow. We can now bring that down and lower the opacity. Remember, we can lower the opacity of this using the number key, so we can try 50% opacity, maybe 60%. No, 50% was better. Let's go back to that. And there is the shadow of Brown on the fence behind. In fact, you can just about see. I tell you what, let's inverse this. Make it a white shadow. You can see it's showing up on the bush in the distance as well. We don't want that to happen, so we can make a layer mask for it. We don't, of course, need to recreate the layer mask from scratch because we already have the layer mask. It's the one we made for Gordon's body. So we can hold the Command or Control key down and click on the layer mask, even though it's disabled, and it loads that as a selection. We can now, on the shadow, go to Layer, Layer Mask, and in this case, we want to reveal, hide the selection. Good, got that one right. We can go back and invert the shadow again, so it's black rather than white. unchain it, and now it only shows up where it goes over this fence. And there is this montage, I think, more or less complete.
Well, very good.
Doug, are you still with us? You've gone quiet.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you're back with us again.
I'm just enraptured here, and I'm imagining everyone's applauding out there, so take a bow.
Well, I've covered a lot of stuff in here, but really what I've been talking about mainly is hiding and showing parts of layers selectively. We've gone through a number of techniques. We talked about layer masks, about the fabulous background eraser tool, which always use with the history brush. Always remember to pin that history point before you start erasing. We've looked at the blend if section. We've looked at ways of working on the mask that goes with adjustment layers to hide their effect. And we've covered a number of ways of making layers interact with each other. And that really is what working in Photoshop, creating
forward some of the more creative, more artistic questions rather than the technical questions. Like, for example, got a couple questions about lighting. How do you what goes through your mind when you're trying to visualize the lighting, and what goes where in which direction? Then,
okay. First of all, I always try to make my initial subject as neutral as possible, that isn't always easy. So if I go to, if I wasn't planning on doing this, but I'm going to find this anyway. Here we go. We're talking about image libraries, and I have this rather useful one as well as the the rubber ball faces that I used earlier, one called In Character, and this was published by Photodisc, and now, like everything else, I think it's published by Getty. And it's a great selection of images of people in costume, and actually it's surprisingly hard to find this kind of image. And we can take a picture here and say, all right, I like this this chef over here, let's work with him. The problem with this image library is that the images are all strongly lit from one side. If I happen to have him in a montage where he's over on one side and that's where the light's coming from, that's fine. But generally, that's not going to happen. I'm going to have to add my own lighting to this. So first of all, we need to get rid of the lighting that's already there. And the best way of doing this is to use image adjustments and shadows and highlights. This is a fantastic adjustment. In fact, I'm going to take this down to just the bare basic commands in here to show how well this works. What it's done so far is it's taken out the shadows by 50%. That's the default position. We can take out the shadows more. As I drag this to the right, you can see the shadows getting brighter. But what we can also do is lower the highlights. So it's a bit bright on the left side of this figure. As I drag this, we can see those highlights now getting darker. And we could spend some time playing around with the fine controls in here, but there isn't time to do that today. Let me just show you the difference. This is the image after we've applied this very, very simple and straightforward dialogue, and that was the image that we started with. And to go from this very, very strongly side-lit image into this evenly balanced image in just a single step is a remarkable thing to be able to do. So, in answer to your question, I always start off by balancing the images so that they have very flat lighting. After that, it's simply a case of imagining where your light source is and painting in shadows on one side. In fact, that's largely it, you know, painting shadows on one side. The highlights on the other side is something I do very, very rarely. I did it in the case of the image here because he's standing directly underneath the light. But really, it's painting in the shadow on the side that makes it.
But you like visualize like some imaginary lines coming from your light source radiating out.
Yes, pretty much. You just look at it and you imagine where the light is going to reach and where it's not. So, for example, let's say we wanted to draw a ball. Let's do this from scratch. So I go for the circular marquee tool here, and let's fill this with, yes, I think I'll go for, because I know you like it so much, I'll go for a mid-tone gray again. There we go. So we want to add some lighting on this. We'll use the burn tool, make that bigger, and paint in some shadow around the edge of this. And we can just build it up. I like to work on a fairly low opacity, especially if I was using a mouse, and build it up slowly. Switch to the dodge tool and add a bit of a highlight up in the corner there. Now, one thing that works particularly nicely on an image like this is if you then use the dodge tool and add some highlight where you wouldn't expect it, so beneath the object and on the shaded side of it, and that gives a much more rounded looking effect. Can you see that coming out there?
That'd be like a diffuse type of glow.
Exactly. It gives the sense of ambient light bouncing off an object behind there. And so painting in shadows and highlights is really a matter of adding them on the opposite side to the light source. I don't know if that comes anywhere close to answering your question, but it's a question that perhaps needs answering anyway.
Well, now, a very similar concept was addressed in another question concerning, again, proportion. They were asking specifically about the sky, for example. How would you determine whether or not to distort the sky to fit? But it also came up earlier when we were talking about the head on his body. So do you have any sort of mental tricks that you use to make your proportions look, not necessarily realistic, but at least the way you want them to look?
Yeah. If I were going for absolute realism, then the head, if I'm putting a head in a new body, I would size the head next to the original head first to make it the same size as the original one. And then put it in place on top of it. You know, if the original head was the right size, then this is the same size as the original, it's going to be okay. With things like skies, actually, you can do anything you like to the sky. So,
just because they're so far away?
This is way bigger. Because they're so far away, but here we go, let me zoom right out. I've got a huge sky in this image, and I can choose any piece of it that I want to use. I could make it smaller, I could distort it to a very tall, thin shape. I can bring it down to a very stretched out, squeezed shape. And, you know, clouds are clouds, and clouds always look like clouds. You can do almost anything to skies. It's just a matter of getting the highlights where you want them and getting it looking right in position. Essentially, what I'm saying is if it looks right, then it's right. This is one of the great things about Photoshop. If it looks right, then that's actually what it is.
Well, that's the artistic part. And you've had quite a few years to hone your artistic, your vision. I mean, the first time you dived into this, you were asking pretty much the same questions everybody else is right now.
Yeah. Okay. I take your point. That's a very good question. So let's take our guy here. And we want to bring him into this montage and bring him right to the front, and we want to size him. Well, first of all, if we want him to be on in the same image as Gordon Brown, we need to pay attention to the eye line. This is something that people very, very often get wrong, and it's actually worth making very clear here. The horizon is always on your eye line. This is a really, really important point. So if I put him down there, we as viewers are now slightly below the sky. We're on a level with Gordon Brown, and we're looking up at him. If we put him up here, he's completely out of scale with the picture. If we put him down there, he's out of scale. If you have multiple people in the scene, as long as their eye line is the same, they're going to look like they belong in the same scene. Let me take a copy of him and put him in the background here. Okay. There is our eye line, that's our horizon. In fact, what I'm going to do is bring up the rulers and bring down a guide.
Yeah, I was going to ask you, how particular did you get with this? Did you ever grid it out?
Certainly when I'm doing complex perspective, yeah, I'll very often use a grid. But with things like this, so, okay, we've got him there. If we want to move him back in the scene, I'm going to move the center point of this free transform onto his eye line. And now, as I scale him, I know he's in the right position. I can move him up and down in this scene. And because he's on that same eye line, he's going to fit. Let me move this out of the way again. If we want him to be the right size for this gate, well, actually, I've got Gordon Brown too big in this scene because he's too big for the rest of the house. If I wanted this to be accurate, his hand has got to reach that handle. So really, he would be down to that kind of size. In which case, since that now defines the height of everything in the scene, then Gordon Brown would have to come down to match this, that eye line. There we go. And this guy would have to come down to match that eye line as well.
But it's not as funny.
Get his shadow. But it's not as funny, no. It's for the kind of illustration that I generally do, it's a question of balancing what's real, what's plausible, with what works. And, you know, you can get too hung up on realism, frankly. Making a good picture is more important. It's very often you'll see a movie and you'll see something like someone falling out of a plane. And you look at it and you think, oh, that looks fake. And you think, well, actually, how do you know? I've never seen anyone fall out of a plane. I don't know what it looks like. But you can tell when you look at it whether it's convincing, whether it's not. And in Photoshop, it's about making it convincing, really, more than making it strictly accurate. I'm going to get a lot of flack for saying that.
I understand what you're talking about. You know, you have to balance the art and the draftsmanship part of the thing to get the look you want. I mean, this is something that the goes all the way back to the painters in the 18th 19th century. They experimented with the same thing, sometimes wrong will look right.
No, exactly. Yep. Do you have more questions?
Oh, certainly. Let's, pointing people back to your book, I'm seeing a zillion specific questions, not particularly about this image coming and going. We could spend the rest of the afternoon, we could spend all week talking about them, but they can all be addressed in your How to Cheat in Photoshop book or on your various forums that people like. Let me ask you about you, okay? For the people in our audience that maybe have aspirations to be your competitor one day or something along those, one of my favorite comments in our forums concerning this event, somebody posted, "Steve Caplin is a chopping god," and I just love that. And so I was going to say, so Steve, tell me, how did you become a chopping god?
Oh, well, I started off as a minor deity and worked my way up, of course. I can feel my head swelling. I would like to be able to say, well, you do this course and you go to this college and then you apply for this job and that's how it happens. But in fact, it happens by accident. I was publishing magazines for 10 years, and I started a magazine in way back in 1987 called The Truth, which was a satirical magazine. It was kind of trying to be a British version of National Lampoon.
Mm-hmm, okay.
And it
which
was...
Lampoon was based on Punch, so...
Well, exactly. So these things come and go, yeah. It was the first magazine in the UK to be produced using desktop publishing, using PageMaker in those days.
Okay.
And it won a few awards, and one of the awards came with a video camera and a digitizing board that went inside my Mac Plus. That shows you how long that was. Well, let me take images in, and some very basic image editing software called Image Studio. I started playing around with this, and the magazine... I had to close down after 2 years because it simply wasn't working out. But one day I met, curiously, the editor of Punch, and I said to him, hey, look what you can do with computers these days. And he said, yeah, that's great. Do me a picture of the Queen to go with our feature on the Queen's speech next week. And then he called back and said, that was good. Do me a double-page photo montage cartoon strip And so I started doing that, and then the Guardian newspaper phoned up and said, do one of those for us. And that's just how it happened. So it's a question of
So you're just basically lucky, right place.
You have to be very lucky. That helps. Okay, but for people starting out now, what I would say was, is the most important thing is to get as much work published as you possibly can. Do it for free. Do it for local community magazines. Do it for parish magazines. Do it for websites. Do it for local newspapers.
What about like contests, like Worth 1000, things along those lines?
Entering contest is certainly fun, and you will hone your Photoshop skills that way. However, if you want to end up being used by magazines, by newspapers, they have a list of requirements for any new illustrator or photo montage artist. And way down the bottom of the list comes, can you meet a brief? Is his work original? Is it any good? The very important thing right at the top of the list is, can you meet a deadline? Because it doesn't matter how good you are, if you can't meet a deadline, you may as well not exist. They can't
Hence, you're stressing the shortcut keys and the skipping steps and things along those lines in this presentation today.
Yeah, exactly.
It's gotten to be second nature to you after this time.
Well, you particularly working for newspapers, you have to work quickly. So the images I showed at the beginning, you know, there was that crop circle image.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I had 2.5 hours to do that in. and that 2.5 hours, that is the deadline. What you can't do is say, I need another hour, because there simply isn't another hour to do it. And that is the most important thing. They then want to know if you can meet a brief. So if you can be given an article and interpret it visually, or be given a set of instructions and interpret that. And frankly, they are going to be amused by what they see on Worth 1000 and on all the other contests. But it's the published work, whether it's on the internet or preferably in print, and that is really what's going to convince them that you are a reliable illustrator.
Now, about the nuts and bolts of your work day, you talk about you dialogue back and forth with your editors and things along those lines. Is that all via telephone and email, or do you have to attend meetings and things along those lines?
It's all telephone and email. The only time I ever meet these people is at Christmas parties, actually. And in fact, there are people I've been working for 15 years who I have never met. If I bumped into them in the street, unless they spoke, I wouldn't know who they are. And that's kind of weird. You know, you get to know people pretty well over that time, but not having any idea what they look like, that's quite bizarre.
And a lot of the work you get nowadays comes from your reputation, or do you still have to actively pursue?
I have never actively pursued, actually. People just phone me up.
Again, back to the luck.
It comes from... Back to the luck and back to, well, I mean, how can I say it? I guess I'm pretty good at my job.
You're good. Yeah, you're damn good. They know it.
I can meet a deadline. Particularly for newspaper work, I can meet a deadline, and that is the most important thing. I can't stress this highly enough. The shortest deadline I ever had was for the front page of the independent newspaper, and they wanted a story about how people are becoming extinct, and they wanted a naked man in a glass case in a museum, but it had to be so you couldn't see anything that might be offensive in a family newspaper.
Sure.
And they wanted it in 15, 45 minutes. Well, now, and that was a nightmare.
So basically, you built your reputation however you needed to do it to build your reputation, and now it's your reputation that gets you the work.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, now, going back to some questions that were asked way at the beginning of the show, but I saved them until now. For example, let's say that the assignment you just now mentioned about the man at the Get Glass Case in the Museum, images, where would you get your images, and what type of considerations do you have to take into your mind whenever you're doing this?
Okay. The man at the glass case, actually I modeled him in poser, because I thought that would be quicker than trying to find someone.
By the way, you're back to Dalek voice. So just to let you know.
Oh, I'm sorry. I don't know.
It has nothing to do with you. It's just the internet. It'll clear up in a minute.
Okay. That'll come back.
I'm going to pretend you just said something intelligent because I couldn't understand a word you said.
I, And so that's how I do it all with photo commenting.
So the last thing I heard was you for a particular image, you modeled the man in pose.
Yeah, that's right. Other than that, I take a lot of my own photography. Things like bodies and backgrounds, I get from online photo libraries. And my favorite one is photos.com, who do a flat rate. I think it's about $350, and that's for all you can eat in a year. Sounds like a lot.
Since you work a lot in satire and a lot for news, do you have different restrictions on the rights that you, or actually I'm thinking you might have less restrictions due to parody and things along those lines?
No, not really. When I work for a newspaper or a magazine and they want a well-known figure in, they will usually send me the images. Whether they then pay the photo libraries, I've no idea. That's their problem. I imagine the more honest of them do. But then, you know, you take a picture of, I don't know, Arnold Schwarzenegger, and you take his head off his body, and frankly, no one is going to recognize where that head came from. And when it ends up being a very small part of a finished montage, it's kind of okay, you know, to use images if they're not, if you're not clearly ripping off someone else's work. So it comes down to common sense.
We don't have a webcam here, so you can't hear me grimacing. I'm thinking there might be some variation between UK law and United States law, because in the United States, that's never good, period.
Okay, then the places to find free images are, first of all, the US Department of Defense website, who have a huge range of images of politicians from all over the world, and they are all in the public domain, and yes you can use them.
Anything paid for by taxpayers is, by law, automatically public domain.
Even to people like me who don't pay taxes in America. It's fantastic.
But now, can we go to British
Wikimedia,
and take your images?
You can go to the full montage, and you can buy my images, and then you can do as you like them.
I'm at the British government sites, just like we do. Do you have the same?
No, you can't. They are all not only copyright, but too low res to use.
Okay, so that's just for the United. That's just United States law.
It is, yeah, and it's a real anomaly. I don't know how it worked out that way. It's quite surprising. Wikimedia, of course, is full of images that can be freely used.
For Creative Commons, that kind of thing.
Yep, exactly. And it's very clearly stated, but almost all the images there are in the public domain and so may be used for any purpose.
Now, skipping a bit to try to cover a little bit of other area, as far as assignments you get, do you get more conceptual or do you get literal? Do they say, you know, we need a man doing this, or do they say we need something funny that incorporates this, what?
I get some of both. The best ones are when people phone me up and say, here's the story, we're going to email it over, come up with an idea. And those are always the ones I enjoy the most. I get some newspapers in particular where the illustrations are dreamt up by the section editors. This is the words editors rather than the art editors. And it's always the first cliche that pops into their heads. And so, you know, a story about credit card fraud. Oh, well, they're a fan of credit cards being held like in a poker hand.
So they're basically
I've done that illustration a dozen times.
They're looking for stock art, nothing creative.
Yeah, pretty much. Sometimes I can talk them out of it. So here's an image that I did last weekend. And this was for a story about the death of General Motors. And hey, they wanted a graveyard with lots of General Motors cars as gravestones in the background. I have drawn so many graveyards, and I'm getting sick of looking at the damn things. But then, you know, there we go. I now know how to draw graveyards quickly. So the problem comes when people ask me to draw things that simply don't make sense. So someone will say to me, okay, we've got a story about tax. Can you do a picture of Gordon Brown taking money out of a pensioner's pocket? And I'll say, okay, if he was putting money into a pensioner's pocket, how would that look different?
Okay.
You know, and it's just when you talk to people who are not art editors, who are not art directors, they have a kind of visual block where they're unable to think about things in more inspired terms.
Well, in a way, this is related to our proportion conversation and our business about light. Is you still have to be able to visualize it in your head clearly. In that case, the meaning rather than the particulars.
Yeah, no, indeed. And certainly with light, you know, light is often added simply to add sparkle, which sounds obvious. So, you know, here's a picture I did last week. This was for, did I show this already? I don't think I did.
But just briefly.
This is for Reader's Digest. This is the one about placebos.
So.
Oh, yeah. When I'd finished this picture, I added a lens flare, and you can see it's centered right around the middle of the bottle there, simply because it adds interest and sparkle to it. There's no reason why there should be a lens flare coming out of there, but it just makes a more appealing image. And what people are paying me for is to make appealing images.
And that's
no
your
more
taste.
Than that.
They're paying you for your taste.
In the best circumstances. Sometimes they pay me for their taste.
Or perhaps
in which
your sensibility.
Case, ultimately, well, it depends who you're working for. If you're working for newspapers, they pay me to get the job done quickly. If you're working for magazines, then they pay me to get the job done well. If I'm working for advertising agencies, then they're paying me to get the job done according to the whim of the wife of the chairman of the client on that morning.
There's no bitterness at all there, is there?
This is the reason why these days I turn down advertising work. Even though it pays stupid amounts of money, it is simply not worth the hassle. These people eat your soul.
Well, they have a reputation of their own to maintain, so.
Well, yes, they do. Let's not go there.
About delivery, I mean, do they give you images, or are you pretty much up to your own? And whenever you're done, how do you deliver the image back to them, and in what format, what resolution, that kind of thing?
I deliver the images as, for magazines, 300 DPI RGB JPEGs.
JPEGs, actually?
Always
just for,
JPEGs,
just for the speed?
Yes.
Just for the speed?
Well, if you say a JPEG is a quality of 10, it is indistinguishable from a TIFF.
Okay.
Except it will get there very much quicker. They expect a JPEG, and certainly these days they're all using InDesign or moving to InDesign, so they're outputting their finished pages as PDFs. The images are being turned into JPEGs in the end anyway.
Okay.
The idea that the JPEGs are lossy is, I think, a kind of rather old-fashioned way of looking at it. These days, JPEGs are absolutely fine.
As far as your own working files, getting some questions about those, you know, while you're building them, what kind of sizes are we talking about? How many layers can you run into? That kind of thing.
For a complex file, I can run into 200 or 300 layers.
And what would the actual file size on something like that end up being?
The largest file size, well, they actually tend to even out between 100 and maybe 300 megabytes.
Oh, actually, that's better than I
rarely
thought.
Rarely something much bigger than that, yeah, because a lot of these, a lot of the layers are very, very small. When I work for newspapers, I work at 250 DPI rather than 300.
Because they requested it, or...?
Because they usually supply me with quite low-res portraits to work from. And rather than blowing the images up and then them having to reduce them, it's a happier mix.
It's going to be printed at a lower resolution anyway with the dot grid.
Exactly.
And all that.
This is the thing. People assume that if something's big, it's a high resolution. But when I used to work for billboard posters, you know, a poster that's 20 feet long by 10 feet wide, you think that must have a huge file size. In fact, that poster is printed at 10 dots per inch. So you're, in terms of file size, it's about the equivalent of an A4 image.
Okay, we've just broken the two-hour mark. That's what we promised everybody. And I think we've had a lot of really good information here. However, I would like you to speak for a couple of minutes about the fullmontage.com.
Absolutely. Thank you for letting me do this quick plug. The full montage is my my new website, and what this is, as it says, it's resources for Photoshop artists. And this includes these ready-made objects and complex cutouts, backgrounds, objects separated into front and back halves so you can put things inside them, objects with transparency like this window, loads of people, but people viewed from behind, ordinary, everyday people, people sitting, people working, and objects taken from a variety of positions, and then really transparent objects like glasses and also perspective backgrounds. So if we go through some of the images on here, the cutouts will be things like cranes and barbed wire fences, all the stuff, everything with the background quite meticulously removed, so you can then place this in your montage on top of an image, and for, in this case, between $1 and $3, and you can get an image that you can experiment with and that you can use.
Now, that particular image would have been a nightmare to do. The barbed wire you're showing there, that would be a nightmare if you had to do it yourself.
It was a nightmare when I did it myself. It was an absolute nightmare. It took me hours. But you see, I mean, the other day, I was doing a magazine cover, and it was about pollution, and they came back to me and said, oh, could you just try that with a barbed wire fence in front, as if this was the easiest thing in the world. And I could have said, well, I don't have any pictures of barbed wire fences. Oh, well, send you one. And they would have sent me over a picture of a barbed wire fence with a housing estate behind it. Well, that's not something that a Photoshop artist can use. But fortunately, I had spent the previous weekend on a cloudy day driving around near hilltops looking for barbed wire fences I could photograph against the sky. So, you know, this is the reason why I've created this stuff. I created all this really for my own benefit, but maybe other people will find it useful as well. Interesting thing here, yep.
I was going to say there was an offer you wanted to make.
There is an offer that I'm going to make, and the offer is this, that for, I could talk about this endlessly, but actually what's much better is if you just take a look at the site and try it out for yourself. So if you send an email to steve@thefullmontage.com with Retouch Pro in the subject line, I will send you a $10 voucher for thefullmontage.com. And if you think about it, the $10, well, that's what you've spent listening to me talking today. So you get that $10 back in terms of stuff that may well be useful to you in your Photoshop work.
So perhaps they'll forgive this little commercial at the end here.
Perhaps they'll forgive the commercial at the end. Take the, you send me your email address, subject, Retouch Pro. I will send you the voucher and take a look at the site. If there's nothing there of interest, that's fine. If there's stuff you want, well, try downloading stuff and see how you get on.
Okay, well, let's see. We're at 2 hours and 6 minutes. I think it's a good time to wrap it up. I want to thank everybody for being here.
Lovely audience, if perhaps slightly quieter than the audiences I've been
used to. It's an unusual experience, isn't it?
It's bizarre. I'm just wondering if there's anyone out there other than you and me, Doug.
Oh, no. We still have almost full attendance here. You're holding everybody enraptured.
Delighted.
I get a little chart here showing what everybody's doing. Oh, but stop scratching yourself there. it's new and it's experimental. I want to tell everybody that we are definitely going to be doing more events with Steve Caplin. As soon as we wrap this up here, I am going to go over on the Retouch Pro forums and open a feedback thread in the Retouch Pro Live forum, and I would like your comments, pros, cons, negatives, kudos, and also things that you would like Steve to cover in future events. I don't really know if Steve has time to answer specific questions, but it'd be great if we could get some requests to help us put together future events. And, of course, everything that, in your opinion, we could have done better, done worse, and how, just plain old how wonderful we are. That's always nice.
Well, one thing you and I were talking about, Doug, was the idea of people sending in images and say, you know, what can I do with this? How can I improve it? How can I enhance it?
That we might be able to do, maybe in a future event. It'll be, maybe we'll do a Stump Steve session or something along those lines. You're forcing me to think off the top of my head here. That's not fair. You know, you know how flat it is. And so let's see. Yeah, the feedback thread in the forums, and let's see here. I guess that's pretty much it. I want to thank everybody for showing up. Thank you, Steve. Definitely want to work with Steve a lot more. By the way, the How to Cheat in Photoshop has their own forums. If you want to go over there bother him in person, it's howtocheatinphotoshop.com. I can hardly recommend the book. Obviously, none of that is anywhere near as good as touchpro.com, obviously. we tried to help each other out here. So, thank everybody for coming, and I'll see you in the forums. That's it for the webcast. Bye-bye, everybody.